So we have heard a lot about algae today, but now look at this. It's not an AI artwork or something like that. It's not a piece of design. It's also not some jewelry. It's a diatom, a tiny marine organism, smaller than a grain of salt, or salt sand, sorry. So isn't it beautiful? But its function is pure strength, permeability, and lightweight. So why is it beautiful? And on the other hand, we humans often try to add some beauty to everything we create. Throughout history, our perception of beauty and form and function has changed tremendously. In some eras, such as in the Baroque or Art Nouveau, decoration was really everything. It was an expression of faith, sometimes also of culture, and even today now, of power. And if you look at Bremerhaven in the Goethe Quarter, you find about 560 different houses from an era which is called Gründerzeit, which is similar to La Belle Époque, or it's similar to historism. Like in other cities, these houses are loved by many people because they are decorated with all sorts of flowers, of ornaments, classical ornaments, and other patterns. What you see here are two houses from Bremerhaven, which used to be wealthy at the turn of the century, around 1900, but also two houses from Nice, an old Mediterranean town, which was also quite wealthy. But shortly after that time came an era where there was a counter movement. Adolf Loos created a pamphlet which was called Ornament and Crime. And he stated, the evolution of culture marches with the elimination of ornament from useful objects, which sounds very militaristic. And almost at the same time, modernism evolved. The Bauhaus declared, form follows function, and ornament was apparently stripped away, but not totally. In his book, The Modular, Le Corbusier proposed strict rules of proportion. Likewise, structural details, colors, and materials, as you see here in the house of Hans Scharoun, is still there. So it's very complex, and it has a sort of ornament still. But what remained in our minds was that pure raw function expressed in clean lines and simple structures was desirable. And if you look at our towns, for instance, in Bremen, you see this situation. You see the old ornamented style in this bank in Bremen, and on the other hand, raw function, which was erected around the 80s, and it's still here presently. So this is actually a dilemma, but nature never had this dilemma. In nature, form is function. If you look at the spiral of a nautilus, it creates a stable chamber system. Also, the ribbed structure of a seashell distributes stress and increases stiffness. And finally, the intricate shell of a diatom is a lightweight, highly permeable, and incredibly strong structure. And yet, almost always, the result is astonishingly beautiful. It seems that in the natural world, beauty is not a luxury. It is the most elegant expression of function. We wanted to explore the way humans perceive natural patterns, geometric structures like the ones expressed in nautilus or diatoms. So we asked people of different ages, genders, cultural backgrounds, and professions to rate 50 different structures based on existing diatoms. And the tools we used is cool, called pairwise comparison. In pairwise comparison, you are showed only two objects and are asked which one you prefer. We now got more than 13,000 of such comparisons from 36 different countries. This would be a column on an Excel sheet which is about 80 meters high. So it's a lot of data, and we got more than enough meaningful results. And the results were really striking. You see here now the top 10 most beautiful structures of the 50, and you see a certain pattern. You have a certain high complexity, you have a high symmetry as well. they are never boring, and you have things like gradients and different structures combined. In contrast, the least beautiful or the most ugly structures were rather dull. They had less complexity, impaired symmetry, and angular structures. In some cases, we cannot really explain why they are thought to be really ugly, but there is a clear pattern about that. There are also differences in detail. For instance, in object 33, the people from art and media thought it was really quite beautiful. So it was above average in the ranking, but IT clearly, the IT specialists clearly disliked this structure. And in object 44, you had the reverse situation. So art and media people disliked it, but the IT specialists really loved this structure much more than anyone else. So we still don't know why that is. We have some suspicions, maybe it occurs in some video games or so, but if you have ideas what that could be, please tell us. So here's a sort of paradox. In nature, beauty emerges as a byproduct of function. We humans infer a high value if we perceive something as being beautiful. For instance, a bridge that looks ugly feels unsafe, even if it's structurally perfect. A ship like that, which looks elegant, inspires much more trust, and you can actually trust this because you could sail with this design from 1,200 years ago over the Atlantic. And of course, design and architecture that resonate aesthetically feel more attractive. It's often the reason why you buy something. If you have the same technology and you have something ugly, something beautiful, it's clear what you choose. So beauty we discover is not superficial, it's deeply connected to how we understand the world around us. This makes our research on form and function of marine organisms quite exciting. But what can we do with it? Can we transfer it in some way? Our most ambitious and first approach to transfer that is a software. So it should be a software for beautiful lightweight solutions. And what we have to do seems relatively simple. We have the marine organisms, we have a lot of access, and we can investigate diatoms, corals, and seashells using all sorts of microscopy, but also by constructing these structures. And then this leads to a nature-inspired database, which can be quite big. We've talked about the 50 objects we used for the query, but there is much more. And as the next step, we have to make an assessment, looking at the beauty, but also at the lightweight performance of these things. And once we have a considerable number of objects assessed, and considerable means about 100,000 different at least, we can use deep learning tools to create an AI software. And the plan is to integrate it into a software platform which has a high reach, so that we can reach a lot of engineers all over the world. And finally, the aim is to get beautiful products which are at the same time very efficient. The second approach is quite different. Here the focus is on inspiration. In 2011, I had the honor to lead the virtual Helmholtz Institute Plankton Tech, in which we worked together with a great architect, Jule Pohl. The pavilion they created based on diatom structures was very light, about 700 kilograms for a structure which is 5 times 6 meters, and attractive. It was so attractive that the largest industry fair in the world gave us 100 square meters to present our results. And that is quite unusual, that equals about 15,000 euros. As a third approach, we are using a combination of both inspiration and software development. We do have now advanced methods to analyze the structures of diatoms based on real structures, but also to modify them, to use them for all sorts of things. And this leads to all sorts of results, such as this one, which resembles the architecture of Felix Candela, who is a Spanish-Mexican architect, but this one is much more versatile in terms of the possibilities to use different materials and different structures. It can be adapted to all sorts of situations. It's a dome-like structure, and based on the same diatom, actually, we have this. It's a shade structure, it's a funnel, not a dome, and we plan to build this in Bremerhaven as soon as possible, but made of sustainable material, and it's planned to be used for learning space, for bionic architecture, and similar things. So let's go back to this diatom. This tiny being does not know beauty, it only knows survival. But in surviving, it created forms that moves us with its beauty, at least since microscopy has evolved. And since the first diatoms were seen under the microscope about 200 years ago. So the lesson is this. Beauty is not the opposite of function. Beauty is function, and in its most profound and universal form. And if nature has known this all along, maybe it's time that we as architects and as designers and as engineers as well, remember it too. You can imagine cities where function, sustainability, and elegance are the same thing, and objects where efficiency feels natural because it looks natural. Lives where the things we build are not just practical, but deeply, resonantly beautiful. I think we are on a good way, and I hope we can do it. Let's do it. Thank you.